many professing Christians don't fully understand humanity's fall and redemption, that man was actually made in the image of God, as Genesis 1 speaks of here in verse 26. And we begin to see, though, when they're in this beautiful garden, man, the first woman, they give in to the seduction of the evil one, and they eat of that tree, the forbidden fruit of good and evil. We see all that in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. The result of that is something called original sin. When a person is born, that sin goes from generation to generation. Unless that curse is broken through the reality and the whole fulfillment and the power of the redemption that Christ did on that cross, people go through life feeling broken, crushed, and hopeless. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, I'm coming to you in the name of Jesus, and I'm asking you to send the Holy Spirit down, that the spoken word will take root, and individuals within the sound of my voice will experience the freedom that only you can give, Christ Jesus. Break that curse of original sin through your redemption. Help us to get a deeper understanding of it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then when we take a deeper look at that in Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21, we see loud and clear how this curse came about by the first man and then the second man, Jesus, breaking that curse. So let's take a look at some of those verses here. And starting in Romans 5, 12, where it says, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, and in this way, the death came to all people because all have sinned. It goes on and explains in verse 15 what Christ has done in the middle of all this. And here's what we see when we take a look at that. But the gift is not like the trespass. For many died by the trespass of one man, but much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, overflow into the lives of many. Wow, glory be to God. Now, as we continue to journey through the scriptures, you're going to see the full implication of that. You're going to see how you can experience victory, perhaps like you never had before. But let's continue to follow this journey to get a deeper understanding. Let's continue and take a look at verse 16 of Romans chapter 5 here, which says, nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of one man's sin. For the judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. Praise God. That's what Jesus provided for each and every one of us. And that's what Paul is celebrating here in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, where he says, in him we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. Now, this isn't some kind of cheap grace. This was grace that was bought and purchased for us through the shed blood of Jesus Christ as he died on that cross for you and I, breaking that curse of original sin by one man. Sin entered the world, and resulting in all of sin fall short of the glory of God. But another one, Jesus, who's fully God and fully man, comes to earth, takes our sins upon himself, dies on the cross, and as many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God. Believing in him, receiving that free gift of redemption, just transforms everything. It gives us hope, both now and for all eternity. It allows us to rejoice in spite of the trials and tribulations we're facing on a daily basis. So my prayer continues to be, Holy Spirit, take this wonderful, powerful word that you've gotten here and allow it to become alive within us, that we begin to understand the promises that are available to us now, the power that's available to us now, the purpose that's available to us now, as we meditate on what God's word has to say. So let's continue to take a look at this. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 8 are so dynamic. It tells us, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who's called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in his divine nature. We are able to escape the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in ever-increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to encourage you to pick up your Bible, mark that, go back, read it, meditate on it. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. Many go through life feeling ineffective, unproductive. Here's a formula for feeling effective and productive. To our faith, we need to add some goodness. Reach out. Help those that are hurting. Help those that are in need. Let the light and love of Christ shine in you and through you. Recognize the precious promises that He's given us that we can move, begin to move into the divine nature of the resurrected Lord. That's setting us free from this enslaving original sin that causes us to be ineffective and unproductive. If Satan can't defeat us and destroy us, he's going to try to have us worry. He's going to try to get us to be anxious. He's going to try to have the cares and affairs of the world just bog us down. So we're totally ineffective, unproductive, never really doing anything really great for the glory of God. You see, Jesus wants to do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. He's given you these wonderful promises, and He's given you this formula just laid out for you. And here's a whole sermon right here in these few verses. I'm not going to preach this whole sermon on that, though. I want to encourage you to go and read it. Get a pencil, write in the margin of your Bible or underline things, and as the Holy Spirit just speaks to you, and it becomes alive to you. So that's what the Word of God does. Because once that curse of darkness is broken, you and I are set free like rock gets off a launching pad to do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we can even ask or think. That's why we're told in Philippians 4:19, be anxious for nothing, but everything with prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. These anxieties can press in upon us. The worry can come down. We don't see the full effect that empty cross demonstrates in our lives at this particular time. And that's why we need to ask the Holy Spirit to begin to work within us. That as we begin to read the Word, it becomes flesh and dwells in us. And we start seeing what Jesus desires to do in us at this time in our lives. Okay, Colossians chapter 1. We take a look at Colossians chapter 1 here. And what do we see in verses 11 through 14? Being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of light. For He's rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. When I forget for a moment that Jesus has rescued me, He's broken the curse, and I'm now free, I can start worrying about the past, worrying about the future, letting all those what-ifs come in. For Satan walks around like a roaring lion seeking a mate to devour. He will make you feel cursed. He'll make you feel worthless. And maybe you feel that way at this particular moment. I want to encourage you to pick up your Bible. Read Romans chapter 8. It starts out with no condemnation, takes you all the way through there, and it ends with there's no separation from the love of God. And in the middle of it all, it says, not just some things, but all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. God has called you to be effective and productive. In order to do that, understand that the curse has been broken when humanity fell. And it can go so far, so deep. You don't have to look very far today to see fallen humanity all around. You see the anger. You see the bitterness. You see the suspicion. You see the hatred strangers even have for strangers. People crossing paths, people of different religions, different races, different political parties. There's so much hatred today, so much bitterness today. God has not called us to be bitter, but to get better by getting into His Word, accepting the fact that the curse has been broken, and we're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. So let's get down here into God's Word, and instead of seeing ourselves as being cursed, let's start rejoicing now. Let's thank God for His goodness. Let's thank God for His grace. Let's let the Word of God get deep in our hearts as we do what Psalm chapter 5, verse 11 tells us here. Let all who take refuge in You be glad. Let them ever sing for joy. Spread Your protection over them, that those who love Your name may rejoice in You. Praise God. What happens if we don't experience that? We're going to be experiencing what we read about in Deuteronomy 28:6, that you're going to live in a constant suspense. That's what it tells you, a constant suspense, filled with dread both day and night, never sure of life. So this anxiety is going to just come and squeeze all this life out of you. And you won't experience the hope that you have both now and for all eternity through Christ Jesus. Back to Romans chapter 5, now verse 17. For if by the trespass of one man death reigned through that one man, how much more would those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? When I encounter disappointment, Satan can come and try to make me feel cursed. But God has, I remember, Jesus has set us free from that curse. and we're now liberated. We're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And maybe you've been praying for something over and over and over, and it just doesn't seem to take place. God's delay is not God's denial. Get into His Word. Realize that you are not cursed. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You've been set free from the curse of the law, and you've been made free through the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This transforms the way you think, the way you act, the way you interrelate with other people, because you are then free not to live a life of worry, not to be ineffective and unproductive, but recognize the powerful promises that God has given you. And you're going to add to your faith goodness and virtue. You're going to engage in perseverance. Maybe sometimes I'm hating the waiting, but the Lord is faithful. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And so again, we need to learn how to cast all our cares upon Him because He cares for us. We read that. Yes, He cares for you and me. You see that in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. It says, cast all your anxiety upon Him because He cares for you. And Paul says something very similar to that. Be anxious for nothing. This anxiety can cause you to be ineffective and unproductive. Be anxious for nothing, but everything with prayer and supplication. With prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. Don't forget the thanksgiving part. Let your requests be made known to God. And He'll promise you a peace that passes all understanding. It's yours and mine. Let's just come to Jesus right now. Let's just surrender to Him. Let's believe Him to do exceedingly beyond we can even ask or think. Let's stop seeing ourselves as cursed and hopeless. There's people walking around that'll make you feel that way all the time. You're never good enough. You're always failing. You'll never change. I mean, you've heard the routine. The nag, nag, nag. Satan, he loves to nag. But Jesus has come to set us free. And so we abide in that freedom. That's what we choose at this particular time. We choose joy. We choose Christ. We choose mercy. We choose to believe what He has said about us. Not what everybody else might say. Not what that devil who walks around like a roaring lion seeking to devour may be saying. We know that we are free from the curse of the law because of our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now let's take the next step. Let's cast all our cares upon Him because He's demonstrated that He does care for us. At this very moment, you may be feeling the anxiety, you may be feeling the pressure, you may feel like you're the disciples caught in that storm in Matthew 14:24. You're tossing here and there. You know, fear can begin to gnaw away at you. You can holler, where are you, God? He's right there. He's promised, I won't leave you nor forsake you. Go outside, look around. Look at all that God has created. Let the birds sing for you, and you join Him in that singing and just praise God. Cast all your cares upon Him because He cares for you. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And He promises you a peace that passes all understanding. Right here in God's Word, we get all that. That's why we've got to get into God's Word. As Joshua 1:8 says, it says, always remember what is written in the book of teaching. Study it day and night to be sure to obey everything that is written there. If you do this, you'll be wise and successful in everything you do. Remember what He's promised us in Isaiah 41:10? What does He say to us there? He says, don't worry because I am with you. Don't be afraid because I'm your God. I will make you strong and will help you. I will support you with my right hand that saves you. And that's why James goes on and tells us in James chapter 1:2 when he says, count it all joy. Count it all joy, he says. Count it all joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of faith produces perseverance. The testing of our faith produces perseverance. The trouble is, we often give up. The curse of sin haunting us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But it goes on and says, thanks be to God for that free gift that has been given to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but praise God for the gift that Jesus has provided. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. So we want to get into His Word. Then we've got to say, Satan, the curse is broken. I no longer belong to you. You are trespassing. I'm a child of God. And I'm choosing right now to count it all joy. I'm going to continue to trust God. I believe that whatever this trial is that I'm going through, it's not because I've been cursed, but because I've been blessed, and God's going to have not just some things, but all things work together for good to those who love God and called according to the Word of God. Romans 8:28. Let's get in here. Now, let's get in there and discover that we're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Can we do that? You're not just a survivor. You are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. So we want to get into His Word. We want to get that Word down deep inside of us. Get it down deep inside of us. And that's why Philippians 4, great chapter also. I mentioned to you Romans 8, starts out with no condemnation, ends with no separation. Philippians 4 here, 6 and 7, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. And I'll say it again, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. It. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, as I was just sharing with you earlier. But don't be anxious about anything, but everything, by prayer and supplication or prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And then he goes on, as I mentioned, Philippians 4 is a great chapter. You're going to want to get into it. Philippians 4:19, my God shall supply all your needs according to His riches and grace in Christ Jesus. The curse of original sin has been broken. Jesus Christ took your sins and my sins upon the cross. He died on that cross. He rose from the dead. The cross is empty. And the sunshine of God's glory now desires to come upon you. We just have to remember what His Word is saying. Let's get into His Word. Let's apply that Word. Let's let those precious promises that we read about continue to work in our lives so we won't just be ineffective and unproductive, but to our faith we're going to add goodness and virtue and perseverance, and we're going to just continue to grow in those qualities of what it is to be a child of the living God. A child of the living God. Awesome, God. Again, back to God's Word. Take a look at this right now. Yes, as you begin to hear the music of creation, you're going to experience a new ability to talk to God, to pray. You're going to be able to move into His peace that passes all understanding. You're going to take God at His Word and know that He is true and that God can do everything, but He can't fail. He can't lie to you. He says, this is the truth. In fact, Jesus tells you, He really hits that right home to us in John 14:12. He says, behold, I tell you the truth. I want your attention. Listen to me now, He says. Behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in me, if you adhere to, cling to, and trust in me, He says, if you believe in me, you can do the very works I do. Yes, even greater things, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, I will do it. Wow, what power. Now, He's not a genie in some bottle. You make your wish, and there it is. Jesus summed it up this way. Put first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. In order to put first the kingdom of God, understand, redemption has been provided after for our individual lives that have been cursed initially, the firstborn, through something called original sin. The curse has been broken. As many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, this whole cosmos, that He sent His only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but everlasting life. The birds are part of that great cosmos. God so loved the world. Wow, they just sing and they praise God. And Jesus says, your Heavenly Father, He sees even that little sparrow. Your very hairs of your head are numbered. And if He cares that much about that sparrow, don't you know that He cares for you? God loved you so much that He sent His own Son into the world to die on your behalf. Do you think He's going to withhold any good thing from you? No, let's get into God's Word. That's why we can rejoice. That's why we can know in the depths of our soul that we are more than conquerors. That's why we have to understand that we are free, not just to make it on in the great beyond, but to right now to be effective and productive for the glory of God. There's a hurting world out there. So many people right now are suffering. They're totally alone. Just this past week, some of the incidences that we've encountered, a woman coming to us who's violent, offender, or her violent attacked her, kicked her out of a car when it's heading down a Highway 44. And she just wakes up in the hospital, and through a series of events, she comes and finds a place here. Another woman comes through the door that's been, for years, just been holding inside all this hurt and pain. It was captured years ago, held hostage by 5 men, raped over and over. I mean, this is a hurting world out there. And so, as they come, we not only want to provide them a place to sleep and food to eat, as important as that, but being a holistic program here at New Life Evangelistic Center, we want them to know that there's a new beginning waiting for them. That, you know, if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. Yes, what a mighty God we serve. What a glorious God we serve. And He invites you into His presence at this particular moment that you may encounter that freedom, that freedom. But it takes faith. Lord, I know I can't save myself, Jesus. I know that no matter how hard I try, I'm going to continue to fail you and other people. Forsaking all, I'm going to follow you, Lord. Some of you may feel so defeated right now by sin, habits, things you don't want to do. As Paul declared, the things I don't want to do, I do. The things I want to do, I don't do. What do I do? I've shared this with you before. I'll say it again. Spell the word sin backwards. N-I-S. Now I surrender. Now I surrender, Lord, to you. And now I'm going to live by faith, forsaking all. I'm going to follow you, Lord. I want to come to you right now in the name of Jesus. I'm asking you to pour your Holy Spirit down on me, Lord. And I want to be able to get up. And I want to be able to hear what you're trying to say to me. Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. They know me and they follow me. So how do we recognize the voice of Jesus? So many voices out there. First, we get into His Word. He'll never tell us anything contrary to His Word. This is the foundation right here, the Word of God. And the Holy Spirit begins to speak. And the Lord will prompt us. He will show us. He'll direct us. Sometimes He may even give us dreams that are confirmed by the Word of God. And we begin to move forth by faith, forsaking all, I follow Him. Being free from all this entanglement in the world and being set free from that curse of original sin, forsaking all, I follow Him. And then get into God's Word. Let's continue. Just dig in and see what's He trying to say to us now. Well, 1 Corinthians 15:57 said, thanks be to God. He gives us a victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. It's not in vain. Now, you may be an unsung hero out here, day by day, taking care of a sick loved one, day by day, trying to pursue the things of God. And there's people in your life that are trying to discourage you. They may tell you things like, well, what do you read the Bible all the time for? You never change. They'll tell you this stuff. Like Job's wife said, just curse God and die. I mean, until you absolutely feel broken and hopeless. But not if you get into God's Word. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The mercies of the Lord are new every morning. We can hang on, brothers and sisters. We can hang on for all that it takes. And we're going to be steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of God. There's a work out there for you to do. Massive numbers of people are hungry. So many people are homeless right here in the richest country in the world. And they need help. Now, you can't take them all maybe into your home, but what can you do? They get hungry one at a time, you can feed them. Get homeless one at a time. Your church can join you and can adopt. And it takes a long time then often get people in because of lack of affordable housing and permanent housing at such a time like this. But just letting people know that you love them makes all the difference in the world. Loneliness is the worst form of poverty. Feeling no one cares. Feeling that you're rejected by family and friends. I mean, we'll go out and try to get some people water and food and all that stuff is okay. But what's the most important thing is to let them know that somebody cared enough to visit them and help them. And I praise God for those partners He's blessed us with. Those individuals who are sharing those gifts with New Life Evangelistic Center. Our teams have the supplies they need there. They can keep the utilities on in the safe houses. They can continue to reach out and keep vehicles running to go find the people and help them. So many different needs at this particular hour. How I praise God for those wonderful people that are sharing those gifts with New Life Evangelistic Center at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, at 63166. But the most important thing of all is we want to preach the good news that there's hope through so many different ways, whether it's through radio, whether it's through TV, whether it's through renewable energy, whether it's lifestyle evangelism, whether it's taking people in, whether it's the job training programs, whatever it may be. We want anybody and everybody to know that the curse of sin has been broken. There is freedom. Christ is risen, and therefore there is hope. Maybe you're feeling hopeless right now. Join me. Let's pray. Father, I come to you with that brother, that sister at this moment that's just feeling the pressure, the hopelessness, the discouragement. Lord, I ask that you'd send your Holy Spirit and speak to their heart right now as they come to you and say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me for my sins. Please break this curse of sin on my life. Set me free, Jesus. I want to surrender my life to you. Forsaking all, I want to follow you, Jesus. Lord, now I surrender. I want to surrender to you, Jesus. And I'm asking you to send the Holy Spirit down upon me and lead me and guide me and direct me from this day forth and forevermore. Thank you, Jesus. If that's your prayer, live it. Get into God's Word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Saturate your life with the Word of God. Read 5 Psalms a day if you have to, a proverb. Get into the Gospel of John. Get into Romans, as I mentioned earlier, and Philippians. And there's just so many places in God's Word just waiting for you to open the book and read it. And as you do that, standing on His precious promises, watch Him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.